Hello, and welcome to First Flight, a Star Trek Enterprise rewatch podcast where we are watching and discussing each episode of Enterprise in succession. First Flight is a proud member of the Tricorder Transmissions Network.
This is Commander Tucker of Enterprise. We've got some information you're going to want to hear.
Hi, I'm your co-host, Melanie.
And I'm your co-host, Abby.
And tonight we are discussing the premiere episode of Enterprise, Broken Bow. Broken Bow was written by Rick Berman and Brannon Braga and was directed by James L. Conway. It aired on September 26th, 2001. But as always, before we begin our discussion, we need to issue a read alert.
Tactical alert. All hands to stations.
There are potential spoilers ahead. On First Flight, we might end up talking about any part of the series at any time. And now for a summary of the episode, it's time for Abby's Captain's Log. Okay, Abby, let's go.
Captain Starlog Supplemental.
So my summary for Broken Bow is Earth launches its first Warp 5 starship, Enterprise, and we meet Jonathan Archer and his crew. On a mission to return an injured Klingon to his homeworld, they encounter the mysterious Suliban for the first time.
All right, it's time to deploy our subspace transmitters and get into this episode. Abby, what were your impressions of Broken Bow?
Well, first of all, I have to say that I think that this is by far my favorite premiere episode of a Star Trek series out there. It has so much plot exposition and so much character development in less than 90 minutes that you really feel like you know more than just something superficial about everybody who's a main character and some of the supporting characters by the end of this first episode. And that's amazing. Like you learn about Captain Archer, of course. You always learn about the captain right away, and you learn about the first officer. But we got a great scene with Travis. We got a great scene with Malcolm. We got a lot of backstory on Hoshi. We know Admiral Forrest, who's not a badmiral, which is a really nice thing to see that the first admiral that we get from Starfleet isn't somebody who turns out to be a bad guy secretly or not so secretly. I mean, we learn about Saval. We get a lot of information about where we're going and what we're doing with this new crew. And even though we don't follow up on every single one of those threads as much as I would hope we would eventually, we get a lot of that. And we really see characters that they have thought out and have had a good idea of who they are before they even put the premiere out there. So that's my biggest thought overall.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. There is so much jam-packed into this episode or episodes. It's like a feature movie. And I do think that one of the things that hit me right off the bat is how much these characters gel right from the get-go. And that has always had a big impact on me. And I agree with you. We're introduced to so many different people and so many different plot points. And I think the thing that strikes me the most when I was thinking about this is the progression from the beginning to the end of how the characters are interacting at the beginning to how they are at the end. How much happens on that journey from the ready room where T'Pol won't shake Tripp's hand and there's a lot of snarkiness going on in that scene to the end where it's a love fest and they all want to stay together. So I appreciate that journey.
I do too. And I like how you could see growth between relationships between characters that aren't the mains. Like when you have T'Pol and Hoshi and they do the two different times where they speak in Vulcan language to each other. And the first time T'Pol is so icy and she's so snippy about it. And the second time she's the one who initiates the thank you back to Hoshi because she's realized just how much this woman has to give to this mission and why she's so important, even if she is nervous about the space turbulence. Mm-hmm. So there's character growth between those two characters right there. And that's neat to see. And I think we start to see T'Pol's arc, which we know by the end has her becoming a bit more like the human she's around, but also so much more Vulcan in the essentials of being a Vulcan. And we see her starting to grow and change and being open to that growth and change from this very first episode.
That was very well said. Another pairing that I really like right off the bat is Hoshi and Archer. And I just love the scene where he tries to talk her into leaving her students and knowingly uses Klingon
to entice her into joining the crew. I know that they have somewhat of a previous connection, but I think he's really being honest and earnest when he says to her, "Do you really want someone else to be the first person to speak with another alien race?" I just really like that scene a lot.
I also wanted to mention just about this premiere, which for me is also my favorite Star Trek premiere by far. It is absolutely my favorite. I think they really got the set right. I feel like they got the time period. The feeling of the time period was done very well. The shape of the ship, the way the consoles or the ship are, the hallways, everything, just everything about the ship feels slightly futuristic, but also slightly present, you know, right where it should be. And I appreciate the thought that went into that. I love the sick bay set a lot. For some reason, I just really like the sick bay on the NX-01.
Well, it's full of all of Phlox's creatures. So how could you not love it? It's got little nooks and crannies everywhere that most of our sick bays don't, because he's got a menagerie.
And I love that feature that they have, you know, a Denobulan and everything that comes along with the Denobulan culture and his methodology of healing with the osmotic eel, you know, make sure he comes back tomorrow for osmotic eel therapy. But I will say, and I don't know if you feel this way or if any of the listeners feel this way, but that bio bed with the black squares looks so uncomfortable.
Yes.
It's a metal slab. I'd like to see some cushioning on that. But other than that, even just the scenes with Archer and Phlox and, you know, other pairings, you're right, they really did do a great snapshot of their characterization and their, you know, soon to be ongoing relationships.
Yeah. And I liked too how this was the first of many times, especially this first season, where we see the captain's mess and we see T'Pol and Archer and Trip in there talking and eating at the same time and knowing where this is going further on. We see this first time it happens so awkward, and T'Pol's cutting the breadstick and they're talking about vegetarian, and there's so many layers going on in there. Mm-hmm. And then knowing how this is going to be a constant. In fact, some people make fun of how many times people eat in Enterprise, especially the first season, that, you know, those people on set really got to have good food because there's always food going on. But to know that as this goes on, that set and that room and that dinner is going to repeat itself. But every time the dynamics shift a little bit as they become closer to each other and have more common experiences to draw from, it was a perfect thing to put in that first episode.
You know, that's a really good point. I hadn't thought about that, but that is so true. And I find the eating and the communal eating scenes very comforting. There's something I really like about that, you know, humanizes them, or I shouldn't use the word human, but they're not all human, but I enjoy that as well. Another thing I wanted to appreciate was Archer himself. I appreciate the callbacks to his childhood that they throw in there with his dad. I think that establishes a good deal about Jonathan Archer, where he's coming from. And I love those nostalgic bits, you know, out in the beach in Marin or wherever they are. And when they do lose Klang, or I should say when Klang is abducted, I just love how Archer just jumps into action. No, we're not going back to San Francisco. Like, he is determined, on a mission, tough stuff. Like, he's the Archer we know and love right from the get-go.
Agreed. And I like knowing that chunk of history, and it gives a lot of depth to the reasons why he is doing what he's doing and the reasons why his feelings for the Vulcans are what they are. But also you can see again, how he's willing to change and ask for help and use the Vulcans and their help and their database and all that as he needs to. He's not too proud to do that, but he's still remembering all of the experiences he's had in the past. And one more thing about those flashbacks that kind of takes me into the next thing I was going to say is the coloring and the lighting on this show is fantastic. Like when you go back to the flashbacks and it's all those warmer colors and it's sepia tones and everything is warm and cozy. And then you come into the actual Enterprise where it's very white light blues and grays and very sterile in comparison. And then when you flip onto like the Suliban ship, especially in the time room when we're seeing Future Guy, and the lighting there is kind of a combination of the two as it spills out from Future Guy. I don't know if that was intentional, but it really sets the tone for each of those chunks. And I mean, we're going to have to move into talking a little bit about the Suliban, who I think are such a cool species. And the idea of a sect of a species even being willing to take advice from the future to give them a leg up is so something that I could see actually happening. I mean, you look at now in the world around us and you see people who are willing to do that all the time. So if somebody came and offered people or Suliban that opportunity, they're going to take it. And while I don't think all of the effects with the Suliban hold up decades later, like the under the door thing is a little bit like, wow, I wish they would update this CGI. The idea is fantastic. Like, yeah. Do you know how useful it would be to be able to like squeeze under or through cracks or something? Great genetic trick. Chameleon skin, fantastic. I mean, if you're talking about survival of the fittest, these guys really did pick the things that were going to help them survive. When Phlox is doing the autopsy and talks about all the redundancies and their complex eyeballs, cool. I mean, they're the bad guys. You don't want them to have this leg up, but that is such a cool idea and such a cool concept. And I love their little pebbly skin. Like, I think that's some really neat makeup because they look very different, yet very, they can still emote. The makeup isn't taking away from their ability to use their faces like sometimes it does in other aliens that we've just started to see. So what do you think about Suliban?
I agree with you completely. I think they did a really good job establishing the Suliban right off the bat in this episode. I think they're a very worthy adversary. I find them fascinating. And I really liked the design of that helix with their ships.
Yeah.
That was really cool and interesting. And the whole concept of the temporal war and Future Guy and, you know, and how that's going to play out later with the Zindi, et cetera, starting right here, is really fascinating. I liked that they had this in Broken Bow and, you know, being beamed out, which was really great fun there with their plan B, because that also brings us to the trip into Paul dynamic. I wanted to just mention one thing that leads to that scene with trip into Paul, which is the evolution and journey of T'Pol in this episode. Of how halfway through the episode, she has a change of heart. She makes this decision to follow Archer's orders when she didn't have to. I mean, he said it very clearly. You could have done whatever the hell you wanted to. But no, she's feeling some type of loyalty or some type of, you know, change of heart. And perhaps that's because she had a conversation with Trip where he was saying, you know, you Vulcans, you Vulcans, you Vulcans. And maybe she's trying to prove differently. I'm actually not sure where that motivation's coming from, to be honest. I'd like to hear your thoughts. But I do find that very heartwarming, that scene where Archer's in sick bay and he has that look on his face like, huh, oh, it was her idea? I love that. So something is definitely shifting into Paul.
No, I agree. And I think she's always been one who's marched to the beat of her own drummer. As I was saying, as we see the series go on, we see that even more and more when it comes to things like Vulcan marriages or career choices or any of that, emotions even. She is more willing to buck the status quo than most Vulcans are, whether it ends up with a good result or a bad result. And I also think she is very conscious of her own personal growth and her own set of morality and ethics. And she is going to do what she thinks is right, whether or not that's what the general opinion is. And that's something that I've always respected about her. And she's not afraid to stand up for her opinion, even if it's unpopular, or to change her mind when she's convinced one way or the other. And I mean, like, we're going to get to, she's absolutely sure that there is no such thing as time travel until suddenly she's time traveling all the time. And she's more than willing to say, okay, I was wrong. Vulcan Science Directorate. Hey, guess what? Time travel's a thing. So it's interesting to see that even be part of this first episode, and to see that her dynamics with Archer and with Trip, who are probably going to be the two that she interacts with the most throughout the series, you can already see the deepening of the layers of that relationship and the loyalty that they're starting, and trust that they're starting to build from the get-go. It's a really nice way to set things up.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, even her mother says that you always had your emotions on the surface. I don't remember the exact quote, but she definitely, I've thought about this before, she's not a typical Vulcan, quote unquote. I think she has other parts of her that she wants to explore. You mentioned the Suliban. I really like the smattering of information we get about several of the alien cultures in this episode. Obviously, we see what the Vulcans were like when Earth was first going to launch the NX program. And that's hugely enlightening and interesting to see the Vulcans of this day. And I know that there have been many discussions about this, you know, for hours by many Trekkies out there, but I find that really interesting. I also like the bit of Klingon-ness we get in this one, too, when they go to the Great Hall at the end. And I still want to know what the Klingon said to Archer, but we'll never know. Or maybe someone out there who speaks Klingon knows. But I just love that scene where we get to see the Great Hall and what's going on. And then when that lead Klingon, you know, comes up to them with the knife. And like you said, a lot of ground is covered in this first episode.
Well, and I think it's interesting, too. One of the moments that has always stuck out to me, even from my very first viewing forever ago, was that night vision in sickbay where you start to see the flashes of the Suliban crawling on the walls. Mm-hmm. And Klang knows what's going on, but we're not hearing him speak English. We're hearing him speak Klingon. And everything is flashing, and Hoshi's confused, and Archer's confused, and Klang is just strapped to that biobed, and you hear him say in a voice that is so intense and resigned yet pissed off at the same time, he just says, Suliban.
Suliban.
And that just, I can hear that in my head every single time I think about this episode. So you know that there are so many stories that could be explored there too about the Klingons and the Suliban. Like, he's got history that we're never going to know, but you can tell it's there just by the way he says that word.
You're right. I never thought about that. The Klingons must know a lot about the Suliban because he picked that up right away. I had a couple other thoughts about that. I like that Hoshi is flustered in that scene because it shows how tricky this whole universal translator newishness, trying to establish a dialogue language, is for even someone as brilliant as her. Yeah, she gets flustered. And I like that. Again, it humanizes her. This whole thing is a big deal.
It would have been very different if we hadn't seen her in her element when Archer went to get her, because we saw her being an expert. And then to see that expert being flustered says even more how difficult that must be.
Absolutely. And as we're recording this episode, the actor who played Klang just passed away a few days ago. So I just wanted to mention that I thought his performance was wonderful.
I agree, especially since he was speaking Klingon. And you have to get what you mean through in a language you know most people are not going to understand the actual words. They're only going to understand the feeling and the general message.
Right, right. I also really liked the scene where they rescued him
from
the Suliban. And when Trip is like, thanks, big guy. That's just a great scene. You know, and Archer says, I hope I don't have to carry you out of here.
I don't think that we can talk about this first episode without talking about the infamous theme song. We need to talk about Faith of the Heart a little bit, because we would not be able to accurately do this episode without talking about that theme song, which I personally love. I downloaded it when the show was first on. I also had the CD of the premiere episode soundtrack. I love Faith of the Heart. I love it when it doesn't have the backbeat. I love it when they change it up with the backbeat. I understand it is different than other Star Trek themes, but that doesn't make it bad. And I think it is this being the earliest part of Star Trek history that we see on screen. I think it is a good transition between music that is, you know, contemporary right now and what we think of as music of the quote-unquote future with the themes that come up. I think it's a nice segue. And I love the graphics and kind of the history of flight that goes with it. I think it's fantastic. And I understand it's a very polarizing opinion, but I can sing every word and I'm not sad about that. What do you think about Faith of the Heart?
I like it too. I have no objection to it. I mean, I think the meaning behind it and the lyrics behind it are very fitting for the show.
Mm-hmm.
I like what you said about the time frame of the style of music. And for me, the real kicker is, you mentioned it, the visual montage.
Yes.
Of the opening credits is spectacular.
Yeah.
I'm really into history and I love space history, and just seeing like Alan Shepard and just all of the different components into that small, you know, short little song is pretty amazing accomplishment. And the fact that we see the ship, the Enterprise, as in boat in Archer's ready room, also tie in. There's just something very soaring about it. I love the montage. I do like the song. I like the mellower version better, season one or two. But I also want to give a shout out for Archer's theme, which closes the show. And I'm a big fan of Archer's theme. And I think it's used to great effect in many of the episodes. Oh, which leads me to, from the beginning of the episode, which I completely forgot to say, which is the scene with Trip and Archer in the inspection pod.
When he scratches the paint.
Where he scratches the paint and they've got their, you know, baseball cap on. That establishing shot right off the past San Francisco shot is just so well done. For me, it sets a tone, and I can't really put my finger on it and I can't articulate it, but there's just something about the music into Archer and Trip with the baseball cap. I just think it sets a really neat tone of the series.
I agree. And I think it shows the love from the people who created it, that they love both the characters and the ship. And you see that in those visuals and in that dialogue. And it shows the promise that's to come, that we have this brand new ship. We have these old friends on a new adventure. And it is just a lovely little scene where you can see that they already love Enterprise, even though they don't live there or work there yet. They love this ship as it's being finished up, as it was being built before it was built. The ship is its own character in this show as well. So it's nice to see the ship get a proper introduction as well.
That's true. And seeing it launch never gets old.
No, it's a beautiful
from
shot.
From the speech inside to the shot. It is beautiful. I agree.
Even the shot of the grappler in this and, you know, finding out about the sweet spot. And we've already talked about the captain's mess and the menagerie. They go through this ship and show you pieces that you're going to love and you're going to come back to over and over again. You know, the regular mess hall, all of those things, decon even, which is not my personal favorite, but a lot of stuff goes down in the decon chamber. So it's good to know that all the parts of the ship, and it's like getting a little map, like a cheat sheet of all the great things that are to come.
I agree. Great things to come.
Four whole seasons of delight.
Wait, I think I hear a dog barking. That means we've arrived at the point of our podcast that we like to call Porthos's Pick, which is our favorite part of the episode. Abby, what was your favorite part of Broken Bow?
All right. So this was a really hard choice because there are so many little moments that are absolutely perfect. But the one that I had to pick came from our dear Dr. Phlox, and it was his extra big smile. And I had to pick that one because he has this extra big smile here and in the final episode. So I couldn't think of a better way to bookend this series. What about you, Melanie?
You know, that's an awesome pick. I love Phlox's smile. And I love Phlox. And yes. I just want to say he's a highlight of the series for me. I think the actor is fantastic. The character was fantastic. And like T'Pol, he had a pretty significant arc as well from beginning to end in bonding with the crew, etc. So thanks for the shout out of Phlox.
Absolutely. His optimism can't be taken out of this series because it is such a crucial point. And a new alien race and a different perspective. What a great thing to have in a show about the beginning of all of our space exploration in Star Trek.
Definitely. Well said. My favorite part is the "we can't be afraid of the wind" ensign moment from Archer. There's just something about that moment for me. It's a combination of the buildup to the moment when he's in the ready room with T'Pol and deciding they're going to stay together. And then he comes out and says to everyone, you know, "I hope no one has any plans to go home right now." Something about that combined with the music as, you know, Archer's theme starts to play with them all looking at each other with those knowing looks, knowing that they're about to, you know, head out on the adventure. And then Archer says that poignant, "we can't be afraid of the wind" to Travis. And there's something about the way he says it with the callback to his dad that I have to tell you, I've seen this episode dozens of times and I get misty-eyed every time. I just love that moment.
Yeah, it's definitely a one that gives you goosebumps because it just feels like this really is truly a first chapter and it's gotten you excited to see what comes next and what happens next.
Yeah, definitely.
Transfer of data is complete.
On the First Flight podcast, we always like to share a bit of trivia about the episode with you. So, Abby, what trivia can you share with us about Broken Bow?
Well, I found a really interesting piece of trivia that I wanted to share about Broken Bow. And it is, three of the prominent Starfleet officers are called Admiral Forrest, Admiral Leonard, and Commander Williams. And these names are all an homage to the three lead actors from Star Trek, the original series, DeForest Kelly, Leonard Nimoy, and William Shatner. And in addition, the farmer's name is Moore, which is an homage to Ronald D. Moore. And one of the Vulcans from the High Command is called Toss, which is a reference to TOS, the original series. So lots of little layers in there for the long-term fans.
Wow. I love that. I mean, I'm a huge TOS fan, and I love the homage, the continuity, the beautiful respect of the thought that went into that. That's awesome.
Well, I also like because most of the premiere episodes do have a crossover from some other series, but they couldn't do that with this one because it was a prequel. So instead of actually having a character there, all these homages was kind of their way to make that connection. And I think that is really heartwarming.
Oh, that does warm my heart. My piece of trivia has to do with something that you said in the podcast tonight. I learned that when Hoshi speaks to T'Pol in Vulcan, when she's not happy with T'Pol, that what she's saying roughly translates to "go to hell."
Yes. Good job, Hoshi. That makes me respect her even more. Because that's probably what I would say if I was in that spot right then. Or at least what I would think, perhaps not be brave enough to actually say.
Right. Well, I'm glad that they made up and they're good now.
Yes, me too.
Before we get into our Vulcans verdict, I just wanted to mention a couple points that I left out previously. The first being, I realized that we hadn't mentioned the cold open during our analysis of Broken Bow with Klang running through the cornfield in Oklahoma.
A classic.
That was pretty darn cool. So wanted to give a shout out for that. And also I neglected to name the actor who recently passed away, who portrayed Klang. His name was Tommy Lister, and condolences to his friends and family. And now it's time for our Vulcans verdict, where we will each rate the episode on a scale of 1 to 10 grapplers. Abby, how do you rate this episode?
Oh, the rating at the beginning of something is always hard because you don't want to be too high or too low. But while there were a few issues here and there with this episode, this is a great premiere. It's my favorite premiere of any Star Trek series thus far. And it really lets us get to know our main and supporting cast in less than 90 minutes. And it has the beginnings of so many plot threads that run throughout the series. So I have to give this 8 out of 10 grapplers. Fine start to the series. What about you, Melanie?
I'm with you, Abby. I think we're thinking alike on this one. I adore Broken Bow, and I think it was really, really well done. It's definitely going to get a high rating for me. I also want to leave a little room at the top for the rest of the series, so I'm giving Broken Bow an 8 as well.
Oh, look at us match up.
All right. And if our listeners would like to continue the discussion, how do they reach you, Abby?
The best place to get me is on Twitter, and I'm at Abby M. Summer. That's S-O-M-M-E-R.
And you can reach me at ShuttlePod2 on Twitter. That's ShuttlePod2. Our podcast can be reached at First Flight Pod on Twitter. We want to thank you for sharing this time with us. And as this is our initial podcast, we'd like to take a moment to thank some great people who helped us make this happen. First, we'd like to thank our podcast consultant extraordinaire, Jim Morehouse of the Trek Ranks podcast. Jim has supported us from the beginning with creative ideas, helping us form and mold the concept of the podcast, and with the editing of sound bites. We'd also like to thank Brian Huddleston for designing our First Flight logo and design, and for additional tech support. And we'd like to thank our editing partner, Anya, at AnyaLasagna_3 at Twitter for her amazing work in helping us edit the podcast. Thank you to Jim, Brian, and Anya.
Woohoo!
We hope you'll join us next time when we will discuss Season 1, Episode 2, Fight or Flight. And as always, we leave you with this quote from Captain Jonathan Archer.
The most profound discoveries are not necessarily beyond that next star. They're within us, woven into the threads that bind us, all of us, to each other.